world is a pretty scary place. It's very corporate, very controlled, very out of touch. Celebrities and entertainers often achieve their high-profile life through capitalizing off of the new era of entertainment. But with this, they often stay within this era's bubble. Artists pump out the same content every time because it works. It is a tried and true method of safety, of keeping their fame and money. Music, movies, shows, stand-up, live streams, musicals, and YouTube videos all find a nice little gray area of exploitation, one that can be milked to death for years, allowing multiple trips to the bank. It's very rare that someone comes along to change the game, to challenge the very idea of the current era, and most of all, to actually make a change while doing so. There are very few stories out there of someone reshaping forms of entertainment as we know it. But of course, there aren't none. Enter Bo Burnham. The just 31-year-old comedian has made a massive name for himself over the past 15 years he's had in the public eye, and something here sets him apart from the rest. Bo manages to challenge the very idea of comedy acts, revolutionizing stand-up and musical comedy as a whole. However, I obviously didn't make that entire drawn-out exposition about the end of the world as we know it just to talk about some interesting comedian. No. No, he is so much more than that. Bo Burnham has been challenging the very building blocks for society and the internet as we know it for years, but how so? That, my friends, is a question that will be answered by, like, 1 hour later me, but to get to that me, we must go on a journey and explore the existential genius of Bo Burnham. When you think of icons, or celebrities, or incredibly talented people, they typically aren't 16-year-olds sitting alone in their room recording themselves. Well, that all changed with YouTube. This website allowed for anyone to become a millionaire by sitting in their room doing whatever they want. YouTube was created, and soon slowly altered, updated, and modified throughout 2004 and 5. But it truly began in 2006, which is exactly when
my whole family thinks I'm gay. I guess it's always been that way. Maybe it's because of the way I walk that makes them think that I like boys.
Bo Burnham, or as I like to call him, Robert Roastpork, has been dabbling in musical comedy throughout his school years. He was making a lot of progress, becoming very good at the piano in particular. But what's more impressive was his ability to not look at the piano at all while playing, and sing an entire song while playing. I don't know, I've just never thought about how difficult that is until now. But I mean, I'm only like 15. If I wanted to do something like that, I'd have to be like a decade older, right? Well, Bo was 16 when he made this. There's literally a possibility that he was making this before he could drive.
It's 'cause I'm afraid of the snow, or my favorite color is the rainbow. I don't mean to yell, but I fear I must, 'cause I'm losing the people that I thought I could trust. Even my boyfriend thinks I'm gay. Just kidding.
This video was one originally made for his family and friends, and he uploaded it to YouTube for them to access it easier. But as I said before, knowing how YouTube worked at the time, this video absolutely went viral, and with it, opportunity was presented to Bo. So with this, and just a few months later in March of 2007, he would upload multiple other songs, similar to that of My Whole Family, such as 3.14 Apple Pie.
You know I'm a gangster, you know I do coke, but I had to go to diet because it burned my throat. I've been doing drive-bys all of my life, except the bullets are newspapers, the car is my bike.
These viral videos led him all the way into the year 2008, where in January, he would travel to London, being signed on by Comedy Central to perform in their The World Stands Up show. This was a a smaller performance, sure, but it was a much larger one compared to where he was just months before. And what's even better is that he was easily the youngest person there at the time and ever, having only just turned 18 a few months prior. And with the enormous potential in Bo's career, Comedy Central signed him on for a 4-year deal, which saw his first album, sorta, published to the public, titled Bo for Show. This thing was just as successful as his YouTube videos, so it would have been dumb to not continue this into a full-blown album titled Bo Burnham a year later. And within that time, his hit song I'm Bo-Yo was uploaded to YouTube.
Yeah, I'm Bo-Yo, I'm the greatest rapper ever, and I'll weather your weather, whether you think I'm clever or not, think you're better, you're not, don't need a sweater, I'm hot, I'm a real G-shorty that can really find your G-spot.
YouTube Live happened.
And he's only 18 years old, thank God, you're 18 at least. He's here to play his world premiere of his new song.
And with all of this, Bo would arrive into the 2010s. A new year, a new decade, a new Bo. He made the decently logical decision to turn to stand-up comedy for his next big project. He would spend the year recording and producing Words, 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 and this would change his life forever. Now, I feel like I have to clear something up. Bo is funny, and great at playing the piano, sure. But why did he go so viral? Why is he considered a lyrical genius and a comedian who has completely turned the idea of fame and stand-up on its head? Well, it's because of all of these things. Let's start with Bo's just absolute baseline talent. Most songs he has performed were written by Bo himself, so the lyrics, notes, and the beat. So not only at the age of 19 could he write hilarious and genius jokes rivaling that of 40-year-old comedians.
My 6-song album entitled Bo for Show is currently available on iTunes, with 3 songs that have never been heard on the internet. And if I try to pirate it for free, I'll get AIDS. I would have guessed scurvy.
But he could also back up these jokes with some insane music production behind them. And before the next clip, I just wanted to add another reminder. He was only 19.
And I want you, yeah, like a lawyer slash mathematician wants some kind of proof. And I want you, yeah, like JFK wanted a car with a roof.
Bo often uses his comedy and platform to riff on common tropes in life. He also makes a great use of subverting expectations. And he raps. He's very good at rapping, so just combine that once again with his crazy talent in writing lyrics and...
Because there's an inverse relationship between respect and sex. I'm talking about religious sex, like a Mormon sect that says you can't have sex with members of a different sex, but you can't have sex with members of the same sex. So if the sex can't be different, the sex can't be same, the only sex left is some left-hand shame.
Oh yeah, did I also forget to mention the fair use of abnormal humor as... in what most people would call dark humor, dirty humor, suddenly subversive humor.
Twitter is a lot like crystal meth, because it's really fun to do, and Oprah's on it.
It was these many, many, many things that garnered him an audience, one that would change his life in an uncountable number of ways. But one of them, like I said before, was his first ever big live tour, Words, Words, Words. And I think this tour is the perfect example of all of these things that make Bo unique. However, this show would uncover one more element of Bo that the public seemed to love. His use of... what is it? Oh right, being himself. To start, people loved the way he just butchered hecklers.
It's not finished yet, but the speech...
This is part 2 parts. First, what first I'm gonna do is I'm gonna come in your mom's face, and then... and then I'm gonna wipe it off with the $25 you paid me.
And they loved that Bo never shied away from calling out the many problems, cracks, and hypocrisy in the world's big companies and entertainers, even when it includes his own line of work.
People come to me all the time. They say the same thing. You know, Bo, you're an artist. How do we fix Africa?
Bo riffed on celebrities before and after he himself became one. He almost seems disappointed to be in the position given this massive audience that can decide the fate of his career in an instant. Being given the luxuries of wealth and having an endless stream of possible ways to continue his career and continue going on with his life, contributing nothing. Or at least nothing in his eyes. And while this tour seems to sum up a lot of these things amazingly, seriously, watch Rant, it's really good. There was one song in particular that really captures all of this. Yeah, you probably already know where I'm going with this.
Art is dead, art is dead, art is dead, art is dead.
Art is dead is what I would call, well, one, I'd call it amazing, but two, I'd call it Bo's first real, sort of morbid, existential, whatever you want to call it, song. It's very hard living life when you're given the privilege Bo was given, when they have the potential for developing stress, anxiety, guilt, and depression over things like imposter syndrome, this idea of believing you were not, in Bo's words, worthy of the fame and fortune. Although you look at most celebrities and they continue, I don't know, going out and partying with 50 of their other rich friends in a goddamn global pandemic. They use their wealth, their influence, to get more of it while leaving everyone around them with nothing. And these are all things that Art Is Dead clowns on. Hard.
My drug's attention, I am an addict, but I get paid to indulge in my habit. It's all an illusion, I'm wearing makeup, 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 makeup.
Now, of course, there are amazing things all throughout the special, but we really should move on. The clock is always ticking, as we have learned before, and it's about time we move into 2011, 12, and 13, where Bo was given the chance to perform in multiple movies, actually. But not only this, Bo also went on to produce Zack Stone Is Gonna Be Famous, a mind-bogglingly genius show about a kid, Zack Stone, going through life pursuing fame and life on the internet.
I never really got the chance to talk to her, but that was before I had the best wingman in the world.
Thanks.
Not you, the camera. Oh, Gabby Glasses, you've been promoted to set decorator, all right? Woo, so just dress the set, make it look romantic.
Dress the set.
It has a lot of genuinely hilarious and brilliant moments, and I highly recommend it, even though it lasted for only one season. And now, of course, you've looked at the little loading bar at the bottom, assuming the chapter system is working this video, you probably have already seen that it's about time for Bo's second live show. What? Over the course of years performing Words, 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 the show slowly evolved in numerous different ways. Not only this, but Bo's audience was growing at such a rate that it felt like time for something new. It felt like the time for something different. It felt like the time for... what? This was Bo's new masterpiece, his next massive tour and comedy special for the world to see. Oh, you know, it's nothing too crazy. It's only his massively successful songs, repeat stuff, From God's Perspective, and Sad. So, you know, like, what's the big deal? Well, you know, I'm glad you asked what the big deal is. And as a matter of fact, he released an incredibly well-produced take of the show on YouTube and Netflix, so why don't we take a look?
This is Bo Burnham. He's 22 years old. He's a male. And he looks like the genetic product of a giraffe having sex with Ellen DeGeneres.
Yeah, I think that sums up this pretty well, actually. This show started the trend of Bo taking the horrors of his life and the world as a whole, and even through publicly shoving these horrors in our faces, he still manages to make us laugh. However, that doesn't mean it's all doom and gloom. We've still got that amazing dumb comedy too.
Play an invisible drum. Play an invisible trumpet. Trumpet sound. Drink some invisible water. Oh shit, that water is real.
And I hope there's some surprises for you. Or some, Jesus, sorry. It's a good start. I hope there's some...
He meant to knock the water over. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But you all thought it was an accident. But he meant to knock the water over. Yeah, yeah.
So,
this show opened with an absolutely mind-numbing, genius masterclass of a song, A World on Fire.
This first song is called A World on Fire.
And then it was followed up by like Sad or whatever. I don't really remember what it's called.
I saw a man with only one eye in a 3D movie. I saw a little boy drop his ice cream cone directly on his mother's corpse. I saw a kitten stuck in a tree, then the kitten jumped off and he hung itself. I saw a boy who had red hair.
Okay, I'm just kidding. Sad 2 was a genius song, all about the terrible things going on in the world, like boys who have red hair. And because of these awful things, people swarm to entertainers to forget about the world, and the entertainers such as Bo attempt to heal the world with laughter, or comedy, one may say. It sounds a little familiar, doesn't it? And I must say, with all of these jokes, Bo sure fulfilled his ultimate goal.
I don't want you leaving the show thinking, my hands hurt from clapping, my stomach hurts from laughing. I just want you leaving the show thinking, alright.
And you know what? Sticking with the theme of words, 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 I think it's about time I introduced you to repeat stuff.
Basically, it's a song and it mocks the way that those songs are written, which I think is... What the songs basically do is they're love songs to girls, and they describe the girls as vaguely as they possibly can so that every girl can think that that song's about them. So yeah. It's like, but then it kind of gets a little darker and sort of accuses these young pop artists of being part of this cycle where girls read magazines, feel terrible about themselves, and then these pop stars tell them that they're perfect and that they're beautiful, and the songs, they buy the song, and then the pop stars on the cover of the magazines, they buy a magazine again, so they're like, And it's sort of just like this vicious cycle, and I basically like it's sort of imply that he's working for Satan or whatever.
I mean, yeah, this is a hilarious breakdown of the love song industry nowadays, the formulaic and corporate retexturing of this genre.
I love your hands because your fingerprints are like no other. I love your eyes and their bluish, brownish, greenish color. I love it when you smile that you smile wide, and I love how your torso has an arm on either side. Now.
This was one of the last songs in the special, with some of the smartest lyrics of them all in the show. Its message is both obvious and subtle. And there are points that no one can miss, while also having some that I probably still haven't found. One genius aspect I love about the song is how it was crafted to be incredibly catchy and get stuck in our heads, paralleling these love songs. Oh, and I also love the fact that he repeats stuff about as much as most of the songs he's making fun of, and still gets like twice as much information in the song than the ones he's making fun of.
We know it's not right, we know it's not funny, but we'll stop beating this dead horse when it stops spitting out money.
However, one other act sure brought this show to another level. The crazy, clever lyrics, amazing use of music and lighting, and the genuinely gut-punching themes of Left Brain, Right Brain. This song is set up to show the audience the difference between the brain's two hemispheres, the logical side and the emotional side.
Here comes a female, here comes a female. Puff your chest out, take your phone and check your email. Our evolutionary purpose is repopulate, so gather data now and see if she's a possible mate. Holy fuck, I think she might be the one.
It establishes what they do and slowly presents a difficulty between the two. And over the course of the song, they begin to fight. They converse about how unhappy Bo is and how unstable his life is, and how emotionally and logically unstable he has become. This leads to more and more arguing, leading to a worse situation, leading to more arguing, driving him into depression, until they decide to perform comedy to cope. They decide to use this as an outlet for Bo, to let all of his feelings, talents, creativity, and smarts to create something special to him. And I would say that is a great segue into We Think We Know You.
We think you've changed, bro.
We know best.
You suck.
We think you've changed, bro.
We know best.
You suck.
We think
we know
you.
We think
we know
you.
We Think We Know You starts off with Bo being confronted by three people. A bratty past college friend that wants to hang out with Bo, totally not because he's rich now or anything. A businessman looking to sign Bo on for a much more mainstream corporate brand deal to water down his content to get more money. And a jerk fan that claims that the fame has changed Bo for the worse. All of these three people have one major thing in common. They think they know him. They also represent the horrors of this fame Bo has been given. The fake friends, the bland corporatization, and the audience. The people he has to please every show, giving them something he himself struggles to find. Joy. And with all of this pressure, Bo goes back to what he does best. turning to his creativity, drowning out these nightmares with his show. Hell, making them a part of the show, leading to this crazy ending. And with that, 2013 ended. And throughout 2014 and 2015, Bo's life changed a bit. He was signed on to multiple shows and movies like before, but this time with much bigger roles. But even after working on project after project, he was still able to return to the stage again in 2016. Again, with a new show, a fully produced performance leaps ahead of anything he had made before. It was time for Bo to make happy. Alright, you know the drill. It's 2016, and it's time for Bo Burnham's newest show. Make Happy was a massively successful tour, seeing shows performed all around the country, drawing in thousands to a single show. Quick reminder that a good 100 or so were at Words. Make Happy was considered to many as the best comedy special of the decade. When this special came around, Bo turned his incredible use of lighting, timing, and studio music to the max. A great example of Bo's increasing talent can be found even in just the intro of Make Happy.
Ladies, ladies, if you feel me, say hell yeah. Fellas, come on, fellas, if you feel me, say hell yeah.
Hell yeah!
If you like drinking booze, let me hear you say hell yeah.
Hell yeah!
If you like smoking weed, let me hear you say hell yeah.
Gotcha.
However, this was followed up by Straight White Male. Yeah, you know where this one is going.
The church has never made me feel ashamed of who I am. But I get emails from Zappos that Gmail doesn't mark as spam.
This song, unlike all of the overly offended straight white men think, isn't saying that straight white men don't have problems. It's saying that their everyday problems aren't as serious as some of the unfortunate events found every day in people's lives that, say, love someone of the same gender. But no one really cares about the message. This song has a dope piano solo. So yeah, clearly this was a professional, well-thought-out show that
Bo had sex with
Robs.
Mom, Bo had sex with
Robs.
Mom, Bo, I heard you had sex with an older woman last night.
I did.
What's her son's name?
Rob, he's right there, I fucked his mother!
This is gonna be a quick reminder that Bo isn't only good at musical comedy, he is also good at visual gags, like his in public urinals bit, or his instrumental comedy in his making peanut butter jelly sandwich while high bit, or his use of just natural comedy, like in his Alabama bit.
We just played in Alabama, they just like the lights. I didn't even need to do jokes. Motherfuckers got moving candles. No, not quite.
Especially the PB&J bit. He has this entire kitchen mapped out in his head on stage. And the audience obviously assumes that he has the ingredients, but it is revealed later that he was holding mayo instead of peanut butter, because he's high. He then gestures towards the audience, which is revealed to be a sink and a wall, and he's just going crazy. So just like this bit, why don't we just stop breaking the fourth wall and move on? But of course, all of these things are usually found in his music too, so why not slap a southern accent on it? This song not only has catchy and genius lyrics, awesome lighting and cinematography, great jokes and hilarious recurring themes, but it also is a jab at modern country music, the bland and corporate watered-down country music that gets thrown around in the music industry. Bo completely mocks the songs by literally just making a list of the phrases you hear in all of them. He puts some slightly altered textbook country guitar in the background and still makes it better than the original music he's making fun of.
Good girl in a straw hat with her arms out in a cornfield. That is a scarecrow. So I take your country girl clothes off,
I put my hands on your body. It feels like, hey, it's a fucking scarecrow again.
Bo would then go on to tell more jokes and sing Lower Your Expectations, another hilarious song tearing apart modern tropes, making fun of how people expect perfect relationships and partners when they themselves are flawed in multiple ways. And if anything, them looking for perfection is another one of their flaws. But just a few minutes later, Bo would be performing Kill Yourself. I mean, if you insist. The message is apparent with this one. Don't kill yourself. This song, if anything, presents suicide as this absurd thing to do. And according to multiple commenters and Twitterers, this song actually aided multiple listeners into avoiding suicide, bringing them lots of joy. And I mean, yeah, how can you not love a song that manages to be fun and catchy when it's filled with this much dark humor?
Stick your tongue in a plug, suck a pipe of exhaust, make some toast in the tub, nail yourself to a cross, hold your breath till it's gone, drink a gallon of mace, be gay in Iran, let Oprah sit on your face.
But just one breakup later, Bo would be performing Can't Handle This, a song you have likely heard of before considering it was Bo's most popular before 2021 rolled around. This song starts off as any other, with a jab at a celebrity, this time Kanye and his many, problems. He goes on to list his own problems, grueling takes on the world and society that deserve way more attention than they get, such as the absurdly small diameter of Pringles cans. This bit is pretty funny, I just love it. He ends up moving onto burritos and them overflowing, and alright, it's not as funny when I try and explain it. I mean, I don't know how you explain this bit.
I'm okay with small mistakes. If you got no more chicken, I'll take pork. But I'll blow my dad before I eat a burrito with a fork. Wouldn't I got the lettuce if I knew it wasn't.
But then the tone changes slightly, and the audience slowly realizes what this song is turning into. At the last moment, Bo changes his points. Forget about the cans, forget about the burritos. His biggest problem is the audience.
The truth is my biggest problem's you. I wanna please you, but I wanna stay true to myself. I wanna give you the night out that you deserve, but I wanna say what I think and not care what you think about it.
Bo goes on to mention how his mental state isn't exactly in the best place to deal with the pressure of being on stage and needing to please the audience. He strives to bring other people happiness when he struggles to bring himself that such gift. We've discussed imposter syndrome, his false friends, and corporatization. But now, we add on depression, societal pressure, the crowd's ignorance, and using his coping mechanism as a means to talk about the thing he's trying to cope for. Bo sees himself as a nobody without the stage here. And in terms of the situation, it is correct. The audience does not interact with this section at all until he states that he should shut up and get back to his job. Following that line, he repeats the burrito tune from earlier, and it is only then when the crowd cheers. Bo is also afraid that he will not make his audience happy. He is worried about becoming another corporate celebrity, and in doing everything mentioned, he becomes depressed, turning to comedy to help, but because no one listens to him off the stage, he uses this moment on stage to speak about these horrible things using his coping mechanism. Bo literally got panic attacks on stage multiple times over the years. He took massive breaks and attempted to better himself in small doses, but none of it worked. Bo was unhappy, still attempting to make happy. However, unfortunately, the only people he could make happy was the audience members. Or at least that's what he hoped. And like, this line, it's this line right here, this sums up all of this perfectly.
Come and watch the skinny kid with a steadily declining mental health, and laugh as he attempts to give you what he cannot give himself.
Think that I can handle this right.
And with this act, the show was ended, and one simple phrase would haunt his live audience for 5 years. I hope you're happy. It's really no question that Bo was in a bad place. So with the end of 2016 and his Make Happy tour, he would end live performances for the time being, moving entirely to two things: bettering his mental health and Hollywood. Bo appeared in Warner Brothers' We Bear Bears, Amazon's Comrade Detective, Studio Canal's The Big Sick, and Sony's Rough Night, all of these throughout 2017. He also went on to produce Jared Carmichael's comedy special on HBO that same year. These performances garnered a lot of attention from Hollywood. I mean, the man can act, duh. He can perform. He's creative as hell. He can write songs, scripts, entire hour-long shows, creating multiple tied-together messages throughout, and receive critical acclaim for all of it. Who would be better to cast as a director, producer, and scriptwriter for a huge emotional movie? What movie exactly? Oh, only the wildly successful and critically praised movie 8th Grade, starring Elsie Fisher, best known before 8th Grade for playing Agnes from Despicable Me. Wait, what?
One more week of 8th grade, huh?
I said one more week of 8th grade, right?
Yeah.
8th grade was a massive 4-year-long project for Bo, this time for the big screen. 8th grade follows the story of Kayla. She records self-help videos and uploads them to YouTube. She is shy, introverted, struggles with anxiety, and that whole coming-of-age story we get tired of in most movies. But this just isn't like most movies. Peter Travers said it all perfectly when he stated that it's basically frustrating that Bo made this, because it's Bo's first movie ever. It should not be this incredible. For starters, this character actually looks like a young teen going through puberty instead of some 24-year-old supermodel. The experiences she goes through are actually scary, if anything. No one told me this was a horror movie. Every time there's a new event, party, or just simple conversation, you are just waiting for the hammer to strike Kayla down, to embarrass the hell out of her. The audience feels anxious through the whole thing. Bo put a lot of emphasis on focusing on a kid trying to make it on YouTube, instead of being another movie that makes fun of big YouTubers with massive platforms. He wanted to focus on the small channels, the children and often adults too, that see these big creators and try to be like them. It's awkward, it's raw, and it's very interesting. And I'm glad we finally got into something that I... well, I can kind of understand.
We're here playing Octodad. Oh my foot!
Bo is noted to be inspired by his own life when thinking about this movie. We just went over Bo's many, interesting life hurdles he was trying to overcome, and he has stated that, if anything, the main character is more of a reflection of his current self rather than his middle school self. Being confused, anxious, things are changing rapidly, not particularly fitting in anywhere, it gets stressful. And no, I'm not gonna act like I understand any of this shit. I would say that I'm better at dealing with stress than others I know, but I don't have it figured out. You know, it's only like a third of this movie's message was the hypocrisy of giving advice when you yourself are struggling from those exact same problems. Bo's cinematography focuses a lot more on the characters, getting shots that actually service the scene and symbolism instead of a cool spinning camera or some fast-paced cuts all over the place. And with Bo's excellent directing and Elsie's magnificent acting, they both continue their journey through Hollywood. Elsie receiving a Golden Globe Award for Best Actress, and Bo moving on to direct Tambourine, Chris Rock's latest comedy special. And then, Bo went oddly quiet. Not disappearing, more just a not performing or directing or anything. The people either slowly forgot about him or began to get confused. Where was he? Where was Bo? What could this 29-year-old possibly be doing that's more important than... Alright, don't lie to me. This is what you've been waiting for. Inside has been nominated for award after award after Award. These songs would then have gone viral past anything Bo could have ever imagined. Hundreds of millions have heard the songs from this special. This movie has garnered a total of above a billion views on TikTok alone. How in the world did Bo manage to reach this massive of an audience? The world had forgotten about this man, and suddenly he comes back with what some are praising to be the single best thing on Netflix. The funniest piece of online content they have ever seen, a genius and absolutely mind-numbing impressive piece of art. Well, obviously there's a lot to unpack. I could cover it all, but this guy spent 2 hours talking about one 50-second long song, so if I tried to break down everything, we'd be here for, let me check the time, a few weeks. So, let's go inside and watch Inside. Inside follows the journey of Bo himself, as he struggles with anxiety and depression throughout quarantine. He uses this time to further his process of getting better mentally, and it only took $4 million from Netflix. The special has a lot of songs, and a lot to say. It is pure Bo Burnham talks about the problems with everything. Some have more upfront messages, like comedy, how the world works, and 30. Some are more subtle, like goodbye, that funny feeling, and problematic, and some you've really gotta dig for that big picture, like White Woman's Instagram, Bezos, and Don't Wanna Know. But every song has its great share of apparent and subtle uses of comedy, themes, messages, and music. The special begins with the straightforward song, Content.
Look, I made you some content. Daddy made you your favorite.
This hilarious introduction is then followed by Burnham's comedy. Comedy is basically used to bring us back to speed, reeling us back into the world of Bo Burnham, showcasing many past elements found in his live performances. The world is falling apart, like, I'm screwed, you're screwed, everybody's screwed, but instead of doing something about it, let's just watch this depressed guy try to make us laugh so we can pretend like these issues don't exist.
If you wake up in a house that's full of smoke, don't panic. Call me and I'll tell you a joke. If you see white men dressed in white cloaks, don't panic. Call me and I'll tell you a joke. Oh shit, should I be joking at a time like this?
Bam, it was great, but let's move on to the next one. FaceTime with my mom tonight. Not much here, but people are really sleeping on this beat. Alright, you know what, I'll admit, that's a lie. Not the beat thing, it's a great beat, but what I said about there not being much here. There are some nice little themes and messages, like this shot of the apologetic, loving shot of Bo, slowly overtaking and pushing away the angry ones. Bo also gets a lot of chances to showcase his great cinematography in this one, and in comedy. But the reason I'm not analyzing these as much as the others is because songs like How the World Works exist. Incredibly thematic, creative, complicated, and amazing songs that honestly deserve their own 30-minute video.
Hey kids, today we're gonna learn about the world.
How the World Works is such an interesting song. It starts off sort of like a Sesame Street song. Bo uses simple, fun, lighthearted music to accompany his fun and catchy lyrics about animals working together to protect Earth and nature.
The biggest elephant, the littlest fly. The gophers underground, the birds in the sky. And every single cricket, every fish in the sea. Gives what they can and gets what they need.
So how could this song possibly fit in with the rest of Bo Burnham's?
No.
Hi, Sako.
The simple narrative taught in every history class is demonstrably false and pedagogically classist. Don't you know the world is built with blood and genocide and exploitation?
Sako. He sits on Bo's hand, sings, and spits facts. He continuously rants about how the world has gone to shit. It's built on genocide. Workers get separated from the actual main means of production in their products. And every higher up protects the interest of the pedophilic even higher ups. However, in this little situation, Bo is the higher up. Sako is on his hand after all, and Bo is just letting him rant about these issues that directly conflict with Bo. And the whole time, Bo is just making these faces like, aww, look at this little tiny sock boy make jokes. Wow, that's really crazy. Basically using facial expressions we use when we're talking to, like, five-year-olds. And it's only when Sako attacks Bo directly that Bo tries to remove Sako from the equation, which he can do pretty easily. Sako began calling out Bo for the self-actualization he had been doing in this song, only barely helping in the vein that he is becoming a better person because of it. Sako is then abused into shutting his mouth, continuing the song till the end. And one little detail that I love is, right after Sako's little rant near like the halfway mark of the song, they sing, "That's how it works," you know, that part. They're roughly equal in volume, and Sako may even actually be slightly more noticeable.
That's how it works.
But after Bo abused Sako, you can hear Bo much more clearly over Sako in the "that's how" part.
That's how.
It's just little details like that that really show off Bo's incredible attention to detail. And it's little details like that which you can find in White Woman's Instagram. The song, on the surface, is just making fun of these Instagram accounts and communities. But it's actually much more him reaching out towards these people, acknowledging the manufactured act that they have to put on to stand out online. But even though it seems like it's basically just making fun of these people, it's so much more than that. First off, the song actually follows a story. The fictional basic white woman we hear about in this song goes from being in love, to having a boyfriend, to being engaged by the end.
Three little words, a couple of doves, and a ring on her finger from the person that she loves.
But not only this, there is also this great middle section about one post, all about this character's mother, sort of a message to her, because she's passed away.
Mama, I miss you. I miss sitting with you in the front yard. Still figuring out how to keep living without you. It's got a little better, but it's still hard. Mama, I got a job. I love in my own apartment. Mama, I got a boyfriend and I'm crazy about him. Your little girl didn't do too bad.
And it's scenes like this that really make you think, wow. This is the same guy that made Bezos?
Come on, Jeffrey, you can do it. Pave the way, put your back into it. Tell us why, show us how. Look at where you came from, look at you now.
This song is great. It's just a stupid breakdown of Jeffrey Bezos' never-ending climb to ruling all of capitalism. Well, there's a lot more to it, but you don't need my explanation when this two-hour breakdown exists, so. Look Who's Inside Again is a great song over Bo's feelings about being trapped inside. That's the name of the... But I will talk more about this message in a bit. But first, this shot. This moment right here. Bo watching the clock, waiting in dead silence for the clock to strike midnight and for him to turn 30 in the middle of working on this project. This is the thing that just gets me the most in the special. There is something so utterly terrifying about this. The helpless stare into the clock, the deadly silence of the room, the sadness of him working during such a milestone. And with this, Bo made his song, 30. 30 is awesome. It's this whole concept of entering your 30s, this terrifying concept of getting older, confronting your future, and letting go of the past. I would say it's also pretty similar to Problematic, confronting the demons of his past that haunt him. I feel like I need to mention that this special wasn't all music. There were plenty of times in between the music telling stories of their very own. These little squished in silent and real moments say a lot. But the patterns and themes you see across them all kind of point to the same three things. The process of creating, the horrifying nature of being stuck inside with your thoughts, and perfectionism. Let's start with perfectionism. After a white woman's Instagram, we see Bo reviewing the footage of it, isolated from the rest of the room, engulfed in the light from his computer, doing nothing but making sure the footage is perfect. We also see multiple instances of Bo ending a song, but the clip continues, dragging on for quite a while, and in two of these instances, he says something along the lines of, let's do that one more time, or let's run that again. Every shot is perfect. The sudden movement of the camera when he knocks it over is this quick glimpse into the reality versus the expectation, which is another thing I found in White Woman's Instagram. Every shot is perfectly framed and all. The next point is this horrifying idea of being stuck inside with your thoughts. Bo is constantly surrounded by and drowning in, well, his thoughts. He is stuck in this room, isolated from society, and doing nothing but working on this project, which as a whole is basically just a showcase of his thoughts, ideas, and views on the world. All Time Low is a great example of this, where it's just this moment where he just snaps out of nowhere. Sure, it's funny, but what is happening is Bo is trying to talk about his mental health, and then he just ends up letting it all out. But these aren't the only things that the theme of being stuck inside brings to the table. He is also forced onto the internet. If he can't go outside and talk to people in person, then he has no choice but to go online and confront this horrifying world. These are themes also touched on in the song Sexting. And finally, we have the process of creating. This basically is the purpose of these songless moments. We see Bo go from enthusiastically introducing us to this new thing he's working on, and over the course of the special, we of course see him surrounded by his thoughts inside. There's a shot of him falling asleep with a spotlight on him. The special is just controlling his entire life. His room becoming nothing but a set to him. Even though the project was eating away at his mental health, it still was his art. His special, his magnum opus, he couldn't just let go of it. All with this beautiful scene at the end, showing Bo still at his house being laughed at by an audience. The stage light never left him. But that's not all that's going on here. It soon cuts to Bo viewing this same clip, the same of him being laughed at outside, and then he smiles. I would say that this is him finally being able to enjoy what he has made, and being able to laugh, smile, and maybe even cry with the rest of the world at what he was able to make. It's amazing.
How are you feeling? Do you like the show? Are you tired of it? Never mind, I don't wanna know.
This song is something else for me. For most that see it, it's a simple bridging point between two acts, demonstrating Bo's hesitancy to view others' opinions on himself. But it is far more than that. This song is an entire analysis of Bo's life on stage. But not just that, it's also about the isolated feeling you can get even in person. Often when talking to others, people put on a little act of their own, leading them to feel disconnected from the real world. People often feel like they are an entertainer themselves, on a stage, and it also can feel like the real you is never heard or understood. So if you've been listening at all for the past 20 minutes, you would understand what these themes are connecting to. And if anything, it's these themes that make it the perfect transition into the second act. It continues the theme of isolation, which becomes like twice as prevalent in the second act as we see Bo turn towards the internet, depression, and the guitar. The putting on an act bit of this is a double-edged sword. On the one hand, I mean, duh, it's about his live performance days, and the toll it took to put on this act, the panic attacks he had, and that people thought they knew him when in actuality, the real Bo was completely unknown. But this is also Bo referring to him turning his personal life, his behind-the-scenes experience, his thoughts and emotions into entertainment, letting the public see what goes on in his mind, and turning his life inside into an act of its own. Is anyone out there? Can anyone hear him? Not Bo, but Robert. And because of this, he feels like
shit, oh shit, feeling like a saggy massive sack of shit, oh shit, big ol' motherfucking duffel bag of shit.
Yeah, even though I can't confidently say I've ever been depressed, I'm pretty lucky in that area, I'd say. I can 100% say that this seems like an accurate representation of depression, considering all of the comments and feedback seen on the song. Unlike what movies may tell you, depression is often not just crying in the corner because you're lonely and introverted. Depression can be much, much more complicated than that. And so the natural progression from this depression is, of course, to worship Jeffrey Bezos in one more song and then hop onto the internet.
Welcome to the internet.
Have a look around. Anything that brain of yours can think of can be found. We've got mountains of content, some better, some worse. If none of it's of interest to you, you'd be the first.
Welcome to the internet. It's the masterpiece you know the special for. I don't doubt that it isn't your favorite song if you were to tell me. All Eyes on Me, That Funny Feeling, and Comedy are all incredible and deserve fandoms of their own right. But there is near zero doubt that this is Bo's magnum opus's magnum opus. The song is funny, terrifying, catchy, unsettling, sad, exciting, surprising, bone-chilling, and overall just disturbing and fun. This is the best way I can put it. There are a lot, and I mean a lot, of dissections of the song on the internet, so I will keep this as short as I can. But basically, Bo is unmasking the internet for the never-ending nightmare it is. He tells this story, all starting with this frame. Bo is dressed almost as if he's a snake oil salesman, a salesman infamous for deceiving you to buy their product. He begins naming some great, intriguing things about the internet. Mountains of content? Anything my brain can think of? And if none of it is of interest to me, I'd be the, like, very first ever? Wow, this internet thing seems pretty nice. The news and famous women's feet? I mean, hey, I don't judge, you do you. Tweeting racial slurs? I don't think I want to be happy? I mean, yeah, I guess I'd like to be horny? Oh, I mean, I probably shouldn't. Be bursting with rage? I mean, I'm about to if you keep just a tip for straining pasta. I mean, thanks, I guess I needed that. A 9-year-old who died. Oh, that's so- Movies! Doctors! Thanks? Fantasy sports! Alright, that's- A man beheaded. I'm offended. Seeing pictures of your children. Okay, now, knowing every thought you think. Okay, I-
Start a rumor, buy a broomer, send a death threat to a boomer, or DM a girl and groomer, do a zoomer, find a tumor in your- Here's a healthy breakfast option, you should kill your mom. Here's why women never fuck you, here's how you can build a bomb. Which Power Ranger are you? Take this quirky quiz. Obama sent the immigrants to vaccinate your kids.
Bo slowly descends into madness, presenting the horrors of the internet for what they are. Everyone's personal lives broadcast to the world, fantasy sports, women's feet, cooking tips, and pictures of corpses all in the same feed, and the corporatization too. The camera also speeds up, zooming in faster and becoming more chaotic as the song goes on. And then the rest of the song happens, but I'm gonna leave most of that to be dissected by the other 80 channels reviewing the special. The only thing I wanted to note here, because I haven't really seen any other channel talk about it, is that part of that slower section in the middle of the song has the same beat in the background as Look Who's Inside Again, just lower and deeper. This is probably a reference to having no choice but turning to the internet and letting it swallow you whole while stuck inside. It's a nice little touch. But before I move on, can we just acknowledge this perfect Disney villain section? Welcome to the Internet was, of course, not the first song in the special to blow people's minds, but it also wasn't anywhere near the last. Right after that demonic Jeffrey Bezos chant I mentioned, Bo would create three mind-numbing masterpieces, starting with That Funny Feeling. This song is set up like a campfire song. He has that nice guitar, a softer voice for this one, some trees projected in the back, and a cool fading in and out orange light in the front to symbolize a campfire. The song is this giant mishmash of the qualities and the enjoyment we get from the modern world and how far we've come.
Deadpool self-awareness, loving parents, harmless fun. The backlash to the backlash to the thing that's just begun.
And on the other side of this conglomeration, we have the horrifying truth. We're screwed.
Female Colonel Sanders, easy answer, civil war. The whole world at your fingertips, the ocean at your door.
This lavish life we can live nowadays is killing our world. Mass shootings, climate change, discrimination, poverty, Logan Paul. We often use self-awareness to acknowledge these issues but not do anything about it. 20,000 years of this. 7 more to go.
Hey, what can you say? We were overdue, but it'll be over soon. You wait.
Bo's next song is often the one he gets the second most praised for, right behind Welcome to the Internet. And, that song, of course, is...
Get your fucking hands up, get on out of your seats, all eyes on me, all eyes on me. Get your fucking hands up, get on out of your seats, all eyes on me, all eyes on me.
This song is also about the world crumbling around us, but instead of being about the world part, it's about the us part. Again, we use comedians, entertainers, and entertainment as a whole to distract us from what we've created. This song walks up to that idea and just kind of drop kicks it into the rising seas. He presents it all in this song, every issue with humanity you can think of, and makes us listen to him. We hear all of it. The climate change, the depression, the internet, the world just ending, and you have to sit there and take it. What are you going to do to help? You turn to Bo Burnham as a distraction, and now you're here, presented with everything you fear and more. You feeling nervous? Are you having fun? Don't worry, it's almost over. Maybe it's just begun. Honestly, the whole song can just be summed up with this line. It's one of my favorites of the entire special.
You say the ocean's rising like I give a shit. You say the whole world's ending, got it already there. You're not gonna slow it, heaven knows you try. Got it good, now get inside.
This song is terrifying, if anything. And it would be a great finale, but he decides to take it one more step further and complete this emotional breakdown trifecta with goodbye.
Possible ending song that is not finished yet. Test. Take one.
The song begins with Bo from when he first started the special, running through a test for this possible ending song. But the screen slowly fades to present Bo, finally ending the special with a year and a half of progress behind him. This song continues as a reflection of the special. He killed Sako again! This song continues as a reflection of the special. Bo worked for a year and a half to get everything he could out, and for the audience, it's only been an hour. Do they understand? Do they like it? Are they satisfied? Will anyone hear him? I guess he doesn't want to know. He then reflects on how difficult it is to do all of this. Even though the audience is the very thing that made him quit life performing, they are one of the most necessary aspects of the comedy. He has come to terms with the fact that he misses us, if anything. He then reflects on his entire career. He is exactly back to where he started 14 years ago, stuck inside his room, alone. Listen, all he's ever wanted is a little bit of everything all of the time. He was stuck inside, took his opportunity to leave and go outside. He experienced it all, and look where that brought him. Back inside. The song ends with Bo completely exposed, accepting defeat as a disembodied voice, a slightly heightened version of the one we heard in All Eyes on Me, taunt Bo. Repeating the main phrase from Look Who's Inside Again. The light here is the same exact light we saw during his Shut Up rant, his song Comedy, and the shot of him sleeping with the stage light following him. Again, Bo went outside. He stayed outside for years, but he finally found his reason to stay inside, and he is promising to never go outside again. And now, we've got you surrounded. Welcome back, Bo. We've missed you. If it were up to me, Bo's story could end here, safe and sound. Having reached all corners of entertainment, early YouTube, small tours, big tours, overly produced comedy specials, movies, shows, awards, a depressing masterpiece, all the way back to late YouTube. Ever since he stepped foot onto the internet, he has been praised. And now, Welcome to the Internet is already his most viewed piece of content ever, garnering 50 million views on the main music video alone on YouTube alone. not to mention the hundreds of millions across all of the other platforms like TikTok, Twitter, and Instagram. Billions of eyes have watched Bo evolve, and now he sits above most, having made a work of art far better and far more in-depth than anything made before it. Bo has gone from talking about how art is dead to outright reviving it, if anything. Bezos, Welcome to the Internet, and White Woman's Instagram are all over platforms like TikTok, having drawn millions upon millions of new viewers closer to his work. He sat in the audience of Phoebe Bridgers, who sang That Funny Feeling during her performance. He has seen show after show receive critical acclaim as some of the best specials on Netflix, period. And his special insight has touched millions, left an impact, and sparked creativity in all of us. Bo made it special by being him, using his intuition, his creativity, and his imagination to make it amazing. And anyone could have done the same, and I feel like this has sparked something in the internet. And at the end of it all, Bo sits and watches as people fall in love with his legacy, and they gather around with him to watch the world burn to the ground.
It'll stop any day now.
Any day now.
Any day now.
It'll stop any day now.
Any day now.
Any day now.
It'll stop any day now.
Any day now.